Well, good and blessed morning to you all again. I have to tell you, I did miss being here. I am very happy to be back up here. It is kind of interesting that after having 2.5 years of every week coming up and being in this place up here with you, that how much it becomes part of my routine and how odd the week feels not being here with you. And I just thank you all for the blessing that you are to me each and every week. I do tell you that I come here today and I'm a little bit more nervous perhaps than normal. We do have a couple of guests, we've got a couple of ministers in the room, and I normally, you know, I'm kind of lucky where I'm not preaching to a lot of ministers, and Mike is here, and then Bob is here, and as I've told you before, Bob was ordained, I believe, in 1949, is that right, Bob? So Bob's preached a couple of sermons. So I've got to do a good job or Bob's going to realize, yeah, that's a high mark for all the sermons he's preached and all the sermons he's heard. But it's a blessing to have them here, both of them here with us. And last week, I understand Greg did a very good job, and I do need to remember to send him a check because he did say nice things about me, so get that. I do need to pay him for that. And Gail sent me, I sent her a text after I, on Sunday afternoon, and asked her how Greg's sermon went. And she said, oh, very well, but he preached for 35 minutes. And I said, good. And she said, why? I said, that way they'll appreciate it when I only talk for 26. So, anyway, as you all know, when I get up to preach, I often am preaching from just the top of my head almost. I prepare for it, so only God knows how long my sermon will. But today we're talking about the parable of the sower, as you might have figured out from the children's sermon. I have preached this scripture here before, and I'll talk a little bit differently about it this time, but I may revisit some of what we talked about before. So, we are in the book of Matthew, the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 13. Let us start off with verses 1 through 9. That same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat by the lake. Such large crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat in it while all the people stood on the shore. Then he told them many things in parables, saying, a farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Some fell on rocky places where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly because the soil was shallow. But when the sun came up, the plants were scorched and they withered because they had no root. Other seed fell among thorns, which grew up and choked the plants. Still, other seed fell on good soil, where it produced a crop, 160 or 30 times what was sown. Whoever has ears, let them hear. Also in Matthew chapter 13, we're going to jump to verses 18 through 23. Listen then to what the parable of the sower means. When anyone hears the message about the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what was sown in their heart. That is the seed sown along the path. The seed falling on rocky ground refers to someone who hears the word and at once receives it with joy, but since they have no root, they last only a short time. When trouble or persecution comes because of the word, they quickly fall away. The seed falling among the thorns refers to someone who hears the word, but the worries of this life and the deceitfulness of wealth choke the word, making it unfruitful. But the seed falling on good soil refers to someone who hears the word and understands it. This is the one who produces a crop, yielding 160 or 30 times what was sown. First, we'll talk a little bit about the scripture, and then I'm going to take a little bit different direction. And you all should be used to me taking a little different direction sometimes on things. But the parable of the sower, as I told the children, sometimes this is also called the parable of the four soils. We look here and we see this farmer, and the last time I talked about this, I really highlighted on the judgment of the soils, that what farmer would go out and knowingly throw seed on a rocky soil or on the path, or even amongst the thorns, that a farmer, you know, wouldn't do that. They would plant the seed, which is a precious commodity, in the soil that they knew it was going to produce well. But the message there, and I'm paraphrasing the message from last time, is that we're not to judge the soil, are we? We're to plant the seed. Let God figure the rest of it out. So, that was in a nutshell what I talked about, I think, for probably 20-some minutes last time. How do you like that? So, that was the moral of the last time we talked about this. Today, I'm taking a little different angle on it, and I'm looking at this, and I'm thinking about the soil. Now, all of us, or most of us here, have farm backgrounds, so at least a generation back, or two generations back, or in our current generation. And as all of you know, I grew up on a farm and ranching operation in South Dakota. The soil means a lot to me. It's part of my heritage. So the soil here, we have this soil where it says the seed was sown along the path that it does not understand the message of God. Here, the path is where they were walking between the fields. The ground was beaten down. And we can liken that to people in this world that have been beaten down by life, perhaps. And oftentimes, unfortunately, beaten down by Christians, either trying to witness to them in the wrong way, or too vehemently, too abusively. Either they be conservative or liberal Christians, it doesn't matter. It's more of the matter that they've been abused. Or perhaps they were in church and someone did something and they didn't like it and they became hard. So seed cannot grow in that hard surface, like we talked about the concrete for the children. The rocky soil, that can be where the seed springs up among the gravel, if you want to think of it that way. That can be the same kind of people, perhaps, but these are the people that we see that jump on each new thing. You get some new age kind of religion that comes along, or you get some, they might dabble in Hinduism or Buddhism or something like that, and they move from one thing to the next thing. They never really settle. They jump around. And they may jump around in Christianity. They might first be this or that. They might even try different denominations, and they might bounce around and never really root, never really prosper in any one place because that ground is still too hard. They can't, the root can't penetrate those rocks. Plus, it's hard to water them. And of course, the people where the weeds are, as Jesus is talking about, these are the people where the troubles of the world and wealth come in. I'd be pretty certain that it's more the troubles than the wealth, because there's just a whole lot more of us that have issues with too little money than those of us that have issues with too much money. But it can be the troubles of the world. My car broke down. I don't have money for rent. All of these things can make it very hard. I don't have money to feed my children. Make it very hard to let faith root because you're worried about what's going on in this world, aren't you? One of the things that they do in mission work, of course, is to try to help people's physical condition, because until you get them to the point where they can deal with their physical condition, it's hard to talk to them about spiritual things. So that's going to be those people. And of course, then, the good soil. When the word takes root, is those that are open and the things are in the right condition, the right time in their life, if you want to look at it that way. Because one of the things about this and thinking about the soil is many of us can identify different periods of our time where we're one or more of these four types of soils. I know at one time I was the hard, rocky path. And by God, that wasn't going to root at all. You didn't have prayer. And that was me. And at one time, I could probably identify with the rocky soil as well. And I can definitely identify, and I think most of us can identify, with the weedy soil. I hope that we can identify with the good soil as well. But here's the thing that Jesus doesn't talk about, and that's watching a video that we talked about in Sunday school suddenly made the light come on. We, as people of the soil, people that have dealt with even just gardening, there's something we know about soil. Soil doesn't have to stay in the condition I find it in. That beaten path, that sidewalk, doesn't have to remain a sidewalk. I can get a sledgehammer out and I can remove that sidewalk. And I can bring it back to being a garden in that spot. I can go up and I can pick rocks and clear that field so that it can bear fruit. most certainly can go out and pull weeds and remove those things that are causing people to fall short of the glory of God. And that's really, we're not only called to be sowers, we're called to be gardeners, aren't we, as well? We are called to be there to help people pull the weeds out of their life. We're there to help pick up those rocks that are in their way. And at times, we're not to walk in with a sledgehammer, because that's one of those things that doesn't work so well when people are really hard. You've got to do it more with a ice pick and do it slowly and gently, carefully. Because those people that are hardened to the word, you can't just come in there and blast them. You've got to work with them. You've got to be patient. And that's one of the attributes of God that is the most endearing, is his great abiding patience. He doesn't feel like he has to get us to where we need to be in one day. In fact, it will take many, if not most of us, a lifetime to get there. We want to be those people that change the soil. Let us always remember that. And now I'm going to take a bit of a different direction. The last time I talked about this, I talked a great deal about my grandfather, Roy Fletcher, the man who I'm named for. And that was a great deal of the sermon focused on Grandpa. He was a man of the soil, he was a farmer. And this parable of the sower, as found in Matthew, was the scripture at his funeral. And so when I read, the sower is found in all three synoptics. It really doesn't matter which one I'm reading it in. But whenever I hear the parable of the sower, I think of my grandfather. And so to me, the parable of the sower doesn't only talk about the soil and the seed. It talks to me very loud and clearly about heritage. Because that's what my grandfather was all about, was heritage. He was born in 1904 at home on a farm just a few miles outside the very, 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 very small town of Reliance, South Dakota. And if you asked him, he would always say, I had the good fortune of being born in the best place on earth and the good sense to stay there. Tell you, I love my grandfather dearly, but he was rooted to that soil. He could tell the story. His father bought the first tractor in Lyman County, South Dakota. His friend's father bought the first car. And I've told stories about that too. Grandpa started, you know, as a child, they were farming with horses, of course. Still time, they had a tractor. But as things changed, he bought a combine, he started doing custom combining for people. He bought a silage cutter, he did custom silage cutting. Some of the greatest memories I have of my grandfather is riding with him in an old silage truck, being a very little boy. Of course, you don't have air conditioning in an old 1950-something silage truck. I told the story the last time about, and I won't go at length into that story, about going with him to an event where I was standing with him, holding on to his pant leg, a very, very little boy, and how everybody came up and said, hi, Roy, hi, Roy, and I was always shocked, and I couldn't feel, I shouldn't say always, I was shocked, and we couldn't understand how all these old people knew my name. Of course, I was named after him. Roy Fletcher. Grandpa was rooted where he was. He had great heritage there. His father had farmed that farm. Every morning when he got up and went out to farm, he could look across the farmstead at the house where he was born, where all his brothers and sisters were born, and where all of his children were born, in that house, across that farmstead. He's buried in the cemetery in Reliance, along with all of my grandparents. One set of great-grandparents. My father's buried there. I told my wife that when I die, I want to be buried in that cemetery in Reliance, South Dakota. She said, why? Well, that's where I started, is in Reliance, South Dakota. I figure that's where I should end. To me, and to most of us, the soil is a big thing. It's where we're rooted. It's our heritage.
heritages are important things.
First Baptist Church here in Lake City was founded in 1861. Pardon me. Shouldn't talk about my grandparents. Its heritage is here in Lake City. It's been First Baptist Church, I believe, from the beginning. It's been in that same location, I think, from the beginning. Is that not right, Bill?
Yes.
They've got deep, deep roots. Woodlawn Christian Church was founded just a few years later in 1865. In 1896, they moved to this location on Woodlawn. Then in 1925, I believe it was, that church burned down. In 1927, this church was dedicated that we are in today. It's a great deal of heritage. In 1865, looking in the Red Book, there's no mention of actually what they called Woodlawn Christian Church at that time. But in 1882, when they filed the Articles of Incorporation, it was called Church of Christ. In 1896, when they dedicated the building on this location, it was called Woodlawn Avenue Christian Church. Sometime later, it became Woodlawn Church of Christ. Then James, back there, remembers when it was changed to Woodlawn Church of Christ Disciples. Later, it was changed to Woodlawn Christian Church, Disciples of Christ, in parentheses. And today, we'll vote and decide whether we add just a little bit to the sixth name that this entity had borne and become Woodlawn Christian Church, Disciples of Christ, an American Baptist. Two churches with extraordinarily deep, deep roots in Lake City, with a great deal of heritage that is in common, having done ministry here in this place, serving and saving and taking care of souls in Lake City. For so many, many, many years. It's an incredible heritage. Greg spoke a little bit about heritage last week. Roots are important things. As I've said, for me, even though I'm here in Lake City, my roots are in Lyman County, South Dakota. You can't understand me if you don't understand the importance of that place, and you don't understand the importance of those grandparents that I helped bury back in that place, my roots. But here's the thing about roots. Roots are there to give you strength, stability, to define you in many ways. But roots are not what reaches to the sky, are they? I'm not in life. That's not where I'm called by God to serve. All the things I went through in my life, good, bad, and different, were to lead me to be here with you today, in this time, this place. This is where my branches have brought me. Where are our branches going to take us from here? You have two tree trunks that are going to come together and entwine. Become one. Two root systems to feed one set of branches. What an incredible amount of strength that is. We don't live in the roots. We live. We serve God in the branches. Let us be branches. Let us be tillers and workers of the soil. Let us take that heritage of the soil and grow that crop 100, a 60, a 30 times what is sown. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so very much for this day. We thank you for the beauty of this place. We thank you for the rich and deep and abiding heritage you blessed us with as a people of yours. Lord, we ask that we remember that the commonality in this name is church. We are your church. We are your people. We are a part of a bigger body, a bigger thing than we can ever imagine. We are just a tiny bit of time and space in your great and abiding and endless creation. And Lord, we just simply and humbly ask that you let us work well and dutifully for you on your behalf in this place and this world. We pray all of this through you and your endless grace and endless love. And